Yeah, my name is Tim Callan. Don't be entirely misled by my title. We are the world's largest commercial public certificate authority, and so compliance for us means a little different than compliance for a lot of companies. And most of what we're doing is focused on, oh, thank you, are you? All right, that's okay. Most of what we're doing is being focused on what it means to provide certificates and PKI that are used, you know, globally by everybody all together. And that's really my focus and my orientation. That's where I'm spending most of my effort here. So, you know, if you thought you were coming here for a talk about GDPR, I'm sorry to disappoint you, you're not. But what I do want to talk about is the concept of passwordless. Because we are providing PKI for 700,000 businesses around the world, we're having a lot of conversations about this now. And people are trying to explore what passwordless means to them. And one of the things that I've been observing in these conversations, and it really kind of bugs me, is that the word passwordless has been co-opted and turned into something that it doesn't mean. So what I'm hoping I can do for you today is I can clarify what is passwordless, what is not passwordless, how they're different, why that different matters, and what you might do about it. Okay? If we can get through that today, I will be very happy. The other thing I should probably let you know, and this will probably come up, this for sure will come up later in the presentation, is I am a frequent PKI podcaster. I think my co-host and I are the only PKI podcasters in the world. And so we're used to slimming things down to a nice, crisp 20 minutes. So I'm going to try to keep this to the point, clear, and explain to you what's going on. We can get way down into the details on this PKI stuff, and we could talk here all day. I'm going to try to keep this directed and focused and make sure it fits within the time frame today. So if there's another level of depth or a level of depth after that you want to get into, we can do that. Come up afterwards, I'll give you a card, and we'll keep talking. But I'm going to try to keep this right size for this presentation, okay? So just a couple things. And I know there's a clicker somewhere. Here we are. There you go. There's a disclaimer. So passwordless is big, right? A lot of people care. We're having a lot of these conversations. And when this happens with these buzzy terms, so a little anecdote. The last time we were all at RSA, by the way, it's great to be back. The last time we were all at RSA, I played a little game with Jason, my co-host, and the game would go, you walk with your head down to somewhere randomly on the show floor, and then you look up, you turn around 360 degrees, and you count the number of times you see zero trust. Because everybody was selling zero trust, right? So it's not that way yet, but I'm watching passwordless go through that same arc, right? And what happened with zero trust is happening now with passwordless is a lot of people care, and so everybody's trying to find a way to glom onto this word. And they're doing it for a bunch of reasons. They want to be in the conversation. They want to participate in that RFP. They want to win natural search, right? And part of the way that you do all that stuff is you start to use that word. And so we're seeing passwordless being turned into things that aren't passwordless. Do you need, am I too loud? I'm always too loud. It's just how I am. Okay. Thank you. So we're seeing that go on now. And my favorite version of this is we just did an episode on this about passwordless OTP, which is kind of hilarious if you think about it, because the P in OTP is password, right? So that's like saying a vegetarian steak knife. And what this does, and it's funny, and we can all laugh about it, but what it also does is it spreads and flattens and dilutes the words until the words don't have meaning. Right? So again, what I want to do here today is I want to go back and recapture meaning. So I'm going to tell you passwordless. I'm going to make up a word, pseudo-passwordless. Or less password is another way to think about pseudo-passwordless. And then what is the difference and why do we care? I just talked about this. But why is passwordless big? This is worth starting because this is kind of our framework. What are we trying to get out of this? Okay, passwords suck. Who loves passwords? Okay, at the crypto forum on Tuesday, Whit Diffie said he loves passwords. He said, I'm the last defender of passwords. So if he were here, I didn't make the grade, Whit didn't come. But if he were here, he would have raised his hand. But other than that, everybody hates passwords. Why do we hate passwords? Well, they suck. We can't remember them, and we're always constantly trying to figure out what this is, and going through password reset is painful, and sometimes it doesn't work, and et cetera, et cetera. But it also sucks for the organization. It sucks for the organization for a few ways, one of which is your employees are miserable. Okay, right there, that's a problem. Number two is your employees are inefficient because they're dealing with tickets and not being able to get in rather than going in, get the thing they get done and get out. And third, which we're going to put a lot of focus on today, is the security is considerably weaker, right? There's a whole family of password-based attacks that just are not available in a true passwordless environment that either are or may be available in a pseudo-passwordless, a less password environment. And that's a key distinction, right? And us as the IT leaders in our community, we're the ones who need to go tell that to the rest of the company, right? Because nobody else is going to get it if we don't. MFA is not perfect either. MFA can help, but MFA isn't perfect. MFA is usually pretty good against a range of very broad attacks. If you're getting phished for your bank account, MFA is a very good solution for that. But if you're talking about targeted attackers who are trying to get inside your organization and get the goods, MFA has its own weaknesses, its own layers around, and people use those as well. And of course, all of this has become accelerated by COVID, right? Because suddenly we're thinking about these things in a way we never did before, and we're using any more of these things. And that's just kind of upped the ante on all of this sort of access stuff, right? And so when you look at all that together, that's the perfect storm of how we're getting what we're getting. Once again, I'm getting ahead of myself. I think I might do this whole presentation. So we talked about the benefits of passwordless, and those benefits are real and they're important. I'm not going to repeat that, except to clarify this reduced support burden, right? Because one of the things that we often don't measure when we're looking at these things is what's the tax on our IT support department, right? How many tickets have to do with password reset or access or things along those lines? And if you go and look into that, which most people don't, everybody's got a steady stream of these support tickets that are going on all the time. And that's an easy thing to quantify. You can go back, you can say how much time are we spending, what's an engineer cost, and you can really put a real cost on that, right? A very hard cost, and that usually isn't done. But I encourage people to do that, right? Because it's part of how you do the arithmetic on this passwordless, not passwordless thing. And then the security, right, like we talked about. So there's this raft. This isn't even all of them. Like, looking at it right now, I realize that I don't have keyloggers in there, right? So phishing, credential stuffing, brute force attacks, man in the middle, keyloggers, et cetera, password reuse. There are places on the quote-unquote dark web. I hate that word because it means nothing, but there are places on the dark web where you can go buy files full of logins, right? Username, passwords. And this is often used for credential stuffing. People will take these things and they'll just run through the whole thing down a script on their target, right? If I buy a big, because password reuse is a real thing, right? So if I want to get into your organization, one of the ways I do it is I buy these massive lists of stolen passwords from consumer applications, consumer sites that are getting usually through phishing. And then what I do is I just run a scripted attack using all these credentials on the login I'm trying to get to. And if one of your employees reused credentials, and if that employee was on that list, then they've now got the credential to get into your network, right? So that's how these things move across. Dictionary attacks, brute force attacks, these are all well understood. Social engineering. Call you up and tell you a good story and fool you, or you know, I'm getting phishing texts now. That's the hot thing. Getting a lot of those, and the reason is that those things work, right? And that's why people wanna move there. And a lot of why they wanna move there is the user experience, right? This big thing we have is they really want the user experience. Passwordless. If you don't type in a password, it's passwordless, right? Right? And that's where the confusion comes in, because the user experience is a benefit. The user experience is not a strategy. The user experience is not an architecture. Passwordless is an architecture. Passwordless is a strategy. User experience is a consequence of that strategy, and not the only consequence, though a very important one. And we will return to that point, because there are scenarios where getting the benefit of the user experience is all that's available, and it's worth it, and it's still okay, but you need to understand that's what you're signing up for and that's what you're doing, right? I'm big about understand what we're doing, know why we're doing what we're doing, and then do the thing we think we're doing, right? And then you get to decide what that is. It's an architecture, right? So, and this is all about a shared secret. So let's just define, again, some terms, and forgive me if these are things that you know, but let's make sure we're all on the same page. A shared secret means that both sides of the communication are depending on the same secret. So a real easy analogy is, remember the old movies where the gangsters and the flappers are going out to the speakeasy, and they knock on the door, and the guy opens his little door by his eyes. He says, "What's the password?" And they say, "Spaghetti dinner." He goes, "Okay, let them in," right? That's a shared secret. So each party is expecting the exact same thing. And your login credentials, when you go to your online shopping account and you put in your personal email and you write, "I love my dog," that is a shared secret, because both parties know the same thing. And that's where we get in trouble. And shared secrets don't have to be passwords, by the way. Passwords are one form of shared secret. There are others. But anything that's identical on both sides, that both sides know, is a shared secret. And the shared secret model is fundamentally fragile, because if you can get in the middle of that, you can steal that secret. I don't care how complicated you make it. I don't care if it's a file or a bunch of ones and zeros or something that no human can read or remember, or if it's 1,000 characters long, I don't care. If you can get in the middle of it, you can steal it, and you can duplicate it precisely. And if you do that, then that's a vulnerability, right? And the password model has that built in a fundamental way you can't ever get around. Now, we do a lot of things to deal with the bad user experience. We say, "I'm gonna put in single sign-on." That's great. I go in, I log in, and I just click the button, and I'm right in Salesforce. And I click the button, and I'm right in ADP. Ain't this awesome? Yes, it's awesome for the user. We're solving the bad user experience. But there's still a shared secret sitting underneath. What do you think Okta or Duo or Ping is doing? They're logging in with your password. That's how they're doing it, right? A password wallet still has passwords. Passwords are in my wallet. I don't need to remember them. I can make them complicated. I can make them unique. That's great. That solves some of the problems that I showed you on the previous slide. That solves some of those problems. Good. It's better than not doing it. Good on you. It also isn't passwordless, because that shared secret is still out there, and if somebody still got in the middle, they could still steal it. Doesn't matter that it's unique. Doesn't matter that it's gibberish to human eyes. It still is stealable, right? Password abstraction layers are not passwordless. Doesn't mean they're bad, but it doesn't mean they're passwordless. And let's know what we're getting and know what we plan to get out of it, right? And these vulnerabilities are still there. Now let's talk about pins. This is another thing that comes up a lot. So say, okay, look, you're going to have a password scenario. I'm going to take my laptop or my phone, and I'm going to go in, and I'm going to connect, and I'm going to connect right in, and it's truly passwordless. And they say, "What are you talking about? I have to type 5 digits into my phone. That's just another password." A PIN is not a password. What we mean when we say PIN, originally it was a personal identification number, because originally it was in form factors that only allowed number input, like at the ATM machine at the bank, right? But what a PIN really is a PIN is a purely localized thing you know. So it's one of the things we talk about in identity. Thing you know, thing you have, thing you are, right? These are the way that we identify you. What's thing you are? That's biometric. I hold the phone up to my face, thing I am. I put my fingerprint on the scanner, thing I am, right? There's others, lots of other biometrics, but those are the two we know best. Thing you know, my password, my PIN. Thing I have, my phone, my laptop, my tablet. Let's talk about how all these things work together. So usually it's two of the three, right? Thing you have, thing you know. thing you have, thing you are, right? And the password is a thing you know that goes across the internet. And because it goes across the internet or across a network, that's where all of these attacks can happen, right? Leaves your secure device, goes out into the Wild West, and then winds up in another secure device down the road. And in here, danger, right? A PIN never leaves your device. I open my device, I type in my numbers. Locally, on local software in the OS, that PIN is authenticated, and then I'm allowed access. It never leaves the edges of this thing, ever. So it's fundamentally different. It's fundamentally more secure. All those things I listed on that other slide don't work, can't work with a PIN, right? So PINs are good. PINs are great. By the way, there are surrogates for PINs that are equivalent to PINs. Having my phone recognize my face? Okay, there may be other problems with that, and maybe I can hold up a picture of someone's face and all that. But setting that aside, from a network architecture perspective, that is every bit as good as a PIN, right? Because it never leaves the phone. There's no way that you can, there's no way that Cozy Bear can go get that, right? It just can't happen. And so this is a very important point, because as I'm trying to talk about, you know, these factors, the thing I have, I can use a PIN, which is the thing I know, without ever leaving my network, without ever going out into a network, to authenticate that the thing I have, my laptop, my phone, my tablet, is okay. And then from there, that device can go out across the network without ever using a password, because I've already done the thing I know locally to tell the distant system that I'm okay for access and permissions. Right? That's passwordless. There isn't a password. There is a PIN, and the PIN's okay. The PIN should be there. The PIN is part of the strategy. Now, pragmatically, this is PKI-based. This is why we talk to people. Because, all right, passwordless as a concept just means there's no password. In principle, it could be done lots of ways. If it happened that there were magic elves and magic elves could do you, then I would say there's two ways to do it, PKI and magic elves. But it happens that magic elves aren't real, right? And PKI is. And so there's really only one way. It's PKI. That is what we have. And again, sorry if this is rudimentary, but PKI, the reason PKI does not have all these problems I talked about is because PKI is based on asymmetric keys, not symmetric keys. It is not a shared secret. What does that mean, Tim? I don't understand what you're saying with these words. Okay, I'll say it real easily. There are algorithms. There's math. And you start with a thing called a private key, and a private key is a very long, unpredictable, let's call it a random number, right? That is very big. And then a mathematical function is performed on that private key, and what you get is what's called a public key. And the public key is a longer, what appears to be a random number. It isn't random, it's based on private key. And you give that to people. And you cannot go backwards. You cannot use the public key to discern the private key. Can't be done. Mathematically, it's not possible. And that's built into the algorithms, and that's proven, and that's proven fact. That's as proven as it gets. But the only person who can interpret anything that is encrypted using the public key is the owner of the private key. And so when you respond to me with my public key, and I know what you're saying, I have proven that I own that private key, and therefore I've proven that I'm the correct recipient for the public key. Now, here's what's great about this. What's the secret? The secret is private key. Is the private key going over the network? No. Is the private key leaving its secure enclave at all? No. The private key is sitting in the single most secure piece of silicon that exists anywhere in your whole ecosystem, and it never leaves it. And the thing that you give to the world literally is a public secret. It's something that any single human being could know, and it would have no negative consequences. So this is different from password. I mean, this is different from a password in that fundamental way, right? Now, what do we do with these keys? What we do pragmatically, again, in the real world, is we wrap them in certificates. A certificate is a wrapper that sits around a key pair, and it has rules. It makes it expire, lets you revoke it, it has metadata, it has things along those lines, right? And those rules are important for certificates to work correctly, but they're really just wrappers, rules wrappers, governance wrappers around private, around key pairs. And certificates are great, right? RSA was invented in the 1970s, and we're still using it. Certificates have been around for my entire career. And they are just about damn near the most well-proven, ubiquitous, well-supported thing that there is. There is no hardware, software, or service that doesn't support public standard certificates, and if they do, then nobody buys them because they don't work. And so in reality, what your passwordless scenario turns out to be is I have a PIN or a biometric on my device. I have a cert on my device locally that is doing a proper PKI, private key pairs communication with my servers. And that is, I will say it, completely immune to all of the attacks that occur in the password-based scenario, right? Like your scenarios where that ATP gets you under those circumstances involve physically being in the same place as the target. Like it's like lift your fingerprint off a glass kind of stuff. Does that happen? A little. Happens in James Bond movies. Once in a while it happens in the real world. But you gotta be a very high value target before that occurs, right? And almost everything we're doing, it's just not practical. People in China or Indonesia who are trying to do this for a living to get into your thing to ransomware you, they're not lifting fingerprints off glasses, right? So we knock most of that out. Now this potentially brings problems because now we're depending on all these certificates, right? And if the certificates don't work, you can't get in. So they have to be deployed correctly, managed correctly, you need visibility, you need renewal. Every certificate expires. That's one of the governance functions of that wrapper, that certificate wrapper, is that every certificate expires. And if you want to have another talk, I'll talk about why expiration dates are necessary. And so all of that stuff becomes your next round of jeopardy, right? My jeopardy shifts from being somebody's going to steal a password and come in and take my goodies, which is worse jeopardy, to a more minor jeopardy, which is I'm gonna have service outages and I'm gonna have access problems. My employee's not gonna be able to get in because the cert on the phone is wrong. My service is not gonna work correctly because my one thing's trying to connect to my other thing and they're not connecting because the cert's expired. And those are bad too, right? We see headlines about all this all the time. A week ago, Spotify had an 8-hour outage and it was because of a certificate management problem. This happens all the time. It's affected everybody. Does anybody remember a few years ago when O2 service was out for an entire day, the entire O2 phone network? Do you remember that? It was about 3 years ago. That was due to an expired certificate. One expired certificate. Who was in the Equifax breach? I was. Lost your PII. 45% of Americans lost their PII. That was due to an expired certificate. So that management now becomes your jeopardy, right? You're shifting risk away from people are stealing a password and gaining bad access, which is the worst jeopardy, to another jeopardy, which is not as bad, but is also bad, which we want to avoid, which is I have certificate management problems because I'm trying to put these certificates everywhere, and therefore I have access problems and all the rest. There are solutions for that. There's a whole category of software called certificate lifecycle management, and there's vendors that are dedicating their engineering resources and their product management team's time to preventing that problem from occurring for you. There are automated protocols. Acme is the best known of them. It's not the only one. So if you like to grow your own and you want to do your own automation on the back end, but you still want all of these things to run correctly, you can use something like Acme or SCEP or EST, depending on the use case. And these things can automatically provision and update these certificates for you as well. So there are options. It kind of depends on what you're doing. That's where you have to sort of look environment by environment, use case by use case, to understand what my automation options are. But there are a lot of A lot of automation. See, now I'm stubborn. I'm just going to get it. A lot of automation options available for you. Say that fast 10 times. And so that's what this turns into. And that's true passwordless, right? That's true passwordless, and that's kind of the holy grail because it gives you all the benefits. Gives you the great user experience. I take my phone, I put in my PIN. I do that all the time. That's easy, right? Or I type in my little phrase on my laptop. I do that all the time. That's easy. I really love the Chicago Bears, right? Boom, I'm in. Easy. People do that all the time. It's cinch. It's not a problem. It all just kind of automatically happens. Great user experience. They're not locked out. They're not having problems. They're not creating health desk tickets. So all of that, they're not losing productivity. So all of those problems get solved. It also gets solved on the security side because that set of attacks that are just such low-hanging fruit for the APTs and the bad guys out there in the world and the phishers and all that, those all just go away, right? So this is the best thing. Now, so great. How come we don't do it? We're all going to go do it everywhere, right? Everyone's going to run out and you're going to be 100% passwordless, right? Wrong. So this can be hard. This sometimes is really hard. You have a bunch of different systems. You're going to have to do them one at a time. At best, you're going to have a phased approach. At best, what you're going to do is you're going to pick your high priority items, you're going to go passwordless on those, and then you're going to go further out in the circle and further out in the circle and further out in the circle until you have full coverage. And most of us are never going to get full coverage because you're going to have some stuff where it just ain't worth it. It's going to be either very low value or it's going to be very, very hard. And this is where legacy systems comes in particular, right? We've got something, it's running, someone wrote it on Fortran once upon a time. And we don't have the source code, and nobody knows how to do it, so we just never touch it, right? We have this. We don't tell people we have this, but we have this. And that's a problem, because this password login kind of thing is hard-coded, and it's difficult to change. It's difficult to put PKI into some of our systems, especially our legacy systems. And then they mix together. And the other thing about those legacy systems is if something is that inflexible and you're still using it, it's because it's foundational. It's essential. It is the reason you're in business. It's what you do. And everything else is built on top of it, right? So once again, it's hard to deal with these things. So really what you're going to wind up doing if you go down this passwordless road is it's going to be a hybrid passwordless, less password scenario. That's what almost everybody winds up with. And even if you eventually want to get to pure passwordless, you'll get there over time, right? And so you got to think about how you mix these things together. So this is where these pseudo passwordless options come back. You know what? I can't get rid of passwords here, but I can mask it. I can use a single sign-on scenario. I can force you to use hard passwords that can't get broken, and I'm going to do that by using a password wallet so that people don't have to remember it and they have the outages and blah, 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 blah. And that's probably what we all really wind up doing. And so I'm not here to dump on less password. Less password is still better. Pseudo passwordless is still better. It solves a lot of problems. Solves that UX problem that we talked about. It solves certain kind of passwords. You're not going to see oversimplified passwords. You're not going to see password reuse. You're not going to see things along those lines. What it doesn't do is it doesn't do all the things we talked about. So then look to this. Also think about what are my opportunities to go passwordless. If I'm touching a system anyway, I got to swap some mouse and put some mouse in. I got to do some major work. We're doing it. Great. Can I put some passwordless in while I'm at it? Right? We're opening it up anyway. We're going through a regression cycle anyway. Great. Why don't I add that to the roadmap and why don't I get it done then? And that's another way that people can incorporate this in a less painful way than trying to go and root it out of everything. Don't fall for the lowest common denominator. Don't fall for the lowest common denominator fallacy. Well, if I can't secure everything perfectly, why bother even trying? Right? Our job is to reduce risk, and reduce risk as much as we possibly can. And less risk is still less risk, even if it's not zero risk. And if you can take systems or sections of your company or entire departments and make them passwordless, why wouldn't you? If it's possible that everybody in dev is passwordless, but you can't do that for the HR department, okay, do it for dev. It's still better. You're still protecting your source code, even if you're not protecting your employees' PII. Like, let's protect the source code anyway, right? And so that's another thing that I think people fall for. Well, I can't solve everything, I won't solve anything. Right? No, solve what you can solve. And this is progressive over time, right? We're gonna get better. I've probably all said this because I said it up front, but what are we doing? Why are we here, right? First of all, just understand, and that's the biggest thing I want to do. This is a framework to think about how we're gonna look at this, right? Where am I going to go passwordless? Where am I going to go less password? When I go passwordless, it's going to be PIN or equivalent and PKI. It just is. Shop for other things, and then when you've done wasting your time, come back to PKI because it's the only game in town, right? So it's going to be PIN and PKI, and we can do that as much as we can, wherever we can, as we can. Phase it in. And recognize there are some things where we may not need to think about other circumstances, where we give them something abstracted. It's much easier for the user, even if there's still going to be a password kind of sitting under, if that makes sense, right? And phase in and hybrid approaches. And clarify this internally, right? I mean, the amount of misinformation on this concept of passwordless is great, because most people just think it means I don't type in a password anymore. And you can be a source of clarity as your organization is making decisions so you know really what you're doing and what you're intending to get out of what you do and how you're going to get there. I told you, see, we make these things quick. I probably have like lots of time left. If you like this conversation, my friend Jason Soroka and I have been doing this for about 3 years. We've got hundreds of episodes. They're all focused in the world of PKI, cryptography, digital certificates, stuff along those lines. We talk about passwordless. We talk a lot about quantum cryptography. Talk about a lot of topics that are hot right now. We'd love to have you join us. Just look for root causes PKI. Do a Google search for that. We'll be the first thing you find. Go listen to us wherever you listen to us. I probably have a whole lot of time left, and I think I'm ready for questions. I do have a lot of time left. Any questions? Yeah. That's a good one, right? So you know, I'm going to take a bunch of things that I can tell about a device, and there's something we call points of entropy, right? Which is there's a certain thing I could look at and I would know about a device. I could say, aha, this is the screen resolution, or these are the drivers that are being used, or this is the version of the OS, or this is the chip, right? And if the more of these things you can gather together, you have more quote-unquote points of entropy, and what you do is you do that to slim down what device you have. And oftentimes these are things that are about your device specifically, like this is going to be true of my laptop. Often it's about me as a user. I tend to come from this IP address, right? And the concept is that the more points of entropy you can apply, you basically make a Venn diagram that's one item big, right? And once you have a Venn diagram that's one item big, you know who that is, right? There are a lot of uses for that. It is not a surrogate, I think, in my belief, sorry for touching the mic, it's not a surrogate in my belief for PKI. Because in the case of PKI, it is mathematically impossible for it to be wrong. There is only one cert in the world that can do this. And no other cert can be created, and that's mathematically proven, and that's proven in real-world application for the last 40 years, right? And so this other concept is great for all kinds of things. If I want to target, if I want to take a visitor to my website and I want to target you based on your interests, it's a great way to do that, right? A lot of great things you can do. But if you think you're going to use it to authenticate that this laptop belongs to this user of mine that I'm going to let into my confidential secrets, you need to be really, really sure that there is exactly one device. I would do that with PKI. I would put a cert on the device. Now you're done. Maybe somebody who's more expert in that might come up here and debate with me, but that's my take. What else? So the question, I'll repeat the question. The question is, what about a customer-facing application? It depends on your relationship with that customer. Let me give you a couple examples. I'm an online retailer, and any rando in the world needs to be able to come and buy paperclips. Okay, you can't do this, right? Out of the question. I'm not going to make you get a cert before I sell you paperclips, right? That's just not going to happen, right? But I have a high-value relationship with an outsider, a vendor, a contractor, a consultant, a customer, a partner. And we are close. We're tight. We're talking all the time. And what's being shared is dangerous and scary. Okay. It is viable. It is legitimate to require PKI under those circumstances. And in an earlier life, when I was a consultant, I had that relationship with some of my clients, where they gave me a dongle, and I had to put the dongle in my computer, or I couldn't get in. And that was okay, because it was worth it. We were working together a lot. It was a high-value relationship. It made sense, and what we're accessing was very sensitive. It made sense. So it's extremely contextual. It absolutely is an option for the right kind of relationship with an outsider. People do a lot with partners, could be technology partners, could be channel partners. They do a lot of that kind of thing. They do a lot with vendors, because the nice thing about vendors is they don't have a choice. Oh, you want my money? Oh, okay, so if you want my money, you're going to use my dongle. Otherwise, you don't need to have my money, right? That usually gets through a lot of problems. The other way is a little harder. Oh, you want my money, so now I have to put in your dongle? But again, if you've got a real good relationship with them and they appreciate the value of it and it's very consultative, then that can be accomplished as well. It's legitimate. It's possible. It depends. What else? Anything else? Yeah, so the question is, okay, I've got a private key on a device, and that's not going to be the device of record anymore. What do I do? You issue a new cert, right? So the great thing about certificates is they're bits. And once you've got a system set up where you can mint and install these things, you just want to mint and install them. And then you revoke the old one, right? They've got to do that, too. You've got to close off the access so that those things don't get out. So, I issue new laptops, right? I've got my employees and their laptops attrition out. They're 4 years old, and we're going to throw them away and give them a new laptop. He just gets a new cert, right? Just don't worry about it. Start a new cert, revoke the old one, make that part of your automated process. Just get on with your life, because who really cares? Did I get the question right?
Yeah, I'm thinking as a follow-up, like, there's a thought of title Mm-hmm.
That's valid. So again, repeating it so everybody can hear. You say, okay, but if I walk into a FIDO kind of scenario, and that's basically a common standard that we can use so that I can use my same authentication across sites without having to do it individually every time. Then if I swap out my key, I've got to go and I've got to re-register it. I'm going to be talking off the top of my head a little. I think that can be automatic. I believe that can be automated. I might be wrong on that, but I think I'm not. And that can make it much easier, right? So again, it's push button simple, and you put it in, and it's done. And if it's not automated, then that's dumb, and let's get that into FIDO, right? But I think it is. Could be. But then what's the alternative, right? I mean, we can't be just slopping our private keys around everywhere. Right? That's not a good alternative. And among other things, you can't take it off the TPM. OS doesn't allow it. I can't go to your laptop and put a command in and say, give me the private key off the TPM. That isn't a thing, right? So to some degree, what do? Now, if you're storing a copy of that private key somewhere else, now you know what the private key is. But if you're storing a copy of that private key in a non-secure enclave, now you're asking for trouble. Because then the bad guys are going to steal that, and they still know your private keys. So I think you just do a new cert. The great thing about key pairs is they're free. The number of numbers is infinite. You can always get another one. And if you've got an automated system and it's push button easy, then it just happens. And if you don't have an automated system and it's not push button easy, then you're headed for trouble, and you need to be thinking about that. Because it'll get you 5 different ways if you don't have that. What else? Does that answer it? Okay. Yes?
You talk about user authentication using PKI on a device that may not have any inputs. Is that possible?
Well, you can. If the device doesn't have inputs, then you're giving up the thing you know, right? So at that point.
I'm sorry.
Yeah.
I guess it could be no exposed ports.
No exposed ports. Yeah. Right. Can't plug in anything. I don't think that's an issue as long as they have a way of having a thing you know secret. Now, it depends on the device, right? And you got to have that as an option, right? So some devices are completely and utterly self-contained, and in that sense, user authentication doesn't make sense. Now, PKI still makes great sense, right? Every computer chip in my car has its own cert on it, right? Because that prevents somebody from breaking into my car using the wireless connected access that's available and taking over the steering while I'm going down the freeway, right? Good thing. We don't want that. And we do that with certs, right? So those are all authenticated, but that's separate from the user authentication concept, right? Fundamentally, for the user authentication concept, you need some kind of input that's going to let you do thing you know or thing you are. There's an iris scanner built into the system, you can do user authentication. If there's a keyboard built in the system or a number pad built in the system, you can do user authentication. If you're not lacking something that basic, it's just not going to work because you need two of those things. So PKI gives us thing you have. Thing you have, solved, right? Solved in spades. But you need thing you know or thing you are, and if you're missing one of those two, all you know is this is the device. Now, for some things, that's fine. I've got a smart meter sitting on my industrial plant telling me what the pressure is on this valve. Great. It's no user. I just need to know that's really the meter, right? Fine. But as soon as we get into something that a person's interacting with and I want to know that this is really the person who's getting access or giving a command or receiving information, then you gotta have one of those two things or you don't know that. Right? I mean, just think about it in simple terms. What if somebody steals it out of your trunk? Another way to think about it is if somebody steals it out of your trunk, are they going to get in? And if the answer is yes, you're missing something you need. Right? And if the answer is no, then you're okay. Right? And that's basically what it comes down to. What else? I'm sorry, one more time? Yeah. Does it add initial? I'm sorry, just the word after initial.
Overheads.
Thank you. I'm sorry. I apologize. Yeah, you got to get set up, for sure. And that's where I talked a couple slides ago about the Acme and the automation. It's probably not worth going to it, but the Acme and the other automation. You're going to have to get set up somehow, and you don't want to do this manually. Can't do it manually. Can't do it with spreadsheets. You're going to need computers doing what computers do automatically when they're supposed to, right? And certificate lifecycle management, CLM, for many of these use cases is your solution. There are just out-of-the-box packages. You buy it, you install it, you configure it, set up your users, and get on with your life, right? Can work with your private CA, can work with your public certs, can work with multiple different sources, can do everything you need to do. CLM for a lot of this stuff is exactly what you need. There are also automated protocols. There's also just hand automation using the RESTful API for whoever you're talking to, right? So these are all options, and it depends on what you're doing. But yes, there's an engineering project, and there's a project to do this, and that's got to be done. It's got to be done correctly, because if it's done incorrectly, then I have problems, because now what I've done is I've as a gating item for all of my operations, I'm requiring that certificates are in place and they're the right certificates, right? So if they're not the right certificates or not in place, stuff just stops. So you do not want that. You want to have a plan for these things to work, and you want to be confident that that plan is going to work correctly. Now, the good news is we are not pioneers, right? People have been developing, figuring out how to do this kind of thing with PKI for decades. So we can simply use best practices and we'll be fine. But you gotta use them or you might not be fine. What else? Yeah, and I don't want to say it depends, so I'm going to say it depends, but I'm going to say more, right? To some degree, it does depend, right, which is kind of what I was saying before. Yeah, I mean, this example you use of the phone and the high net worth individual, that's actually a sticky one, because how am I going to put a cert on that guy's phone? I know how I put a cert on my employee's laptop, and I also know how I put a cert on my employee's phone. Because I say, hey, employee, I'm going to send you an email. This is what it's going to look like. Click on the link. It's going to give you a cert. Say yes. If you don't do that, you're fired. Okay? So that's easy. It may be that the high net worth individual, hey, high net worth individual, we are going the extra mile to make sure that nobody steals your money. What I would like for you to do on a purely voluntary basis or not, depending, is we're going to send you this information. We're going to give you this agent, install this agent. It's going to put a cert on. Now what's going to happen? I'm going to explain to you why this is the most secure thing ever, right? And this is a way where actually security measures, in certain circumstances, security measures actually can become a selling. Like, I'm imagining that's a perfect example. Hey, active investor who's worth millions of dollars, look how hard I am working to protect you, right? That could actually be a plus under those circumstances. Yeah, when we get out of the boundaries of our own employees, sometimes it gets messy, right? Our own employees are accessing our own systems using our devices that we control. It's very clean, it's very universal, it's very easy. Once we get out of that, because I heard this, right, and people get aspirational. They go, awesome, I'm going to do this with my partners too. Okay, let's think about that. Awesome, I'm going to do this with my high-value customers. Okay, let's think about that. And as we do that, it does get messier. And again, what I'm going to suggest, we look at them individually, we figure out what's it worth, what's it going to take, what's the pain, and where am I going to do it? Right? I'm sorry I don't have a real simple answer, but I think that's what it is. Yeah, yeah.
So basically, with the native app, we can, anyone who get into the mobile device, he can get the certificate as well. So how much more secure versus password and certificate in this case?
I think much less so, right? The big benefit that we're getting from peak, now, so, you know, I gave the example of the automobile, right? If you think about that automobile, inside that automobile, that's like its own little network because you got different devices. They come from different manufacturers. They talk to each other across a public interface that they all know, a common interface. That's ripe for exploitation. If you're talking about somebody's Android phone or their iOS phone, those guys are doing everything they can to lock that down in the first place. You don't need to put PKI for internal communication within that device. You're not going to improve your security profile. Think about it, as soon as that device has to go over any network that you don't control, or even that you do, right? Because people break into networks all the time. But as soon as that has to go over any kind of pipe, right? The internet or your own network that you control, as soon as that's the case, that's where you want to be thinking PKI. If you've got a function that's existing just inside a device, a server, an endpoint device, I would put my focus other places.
Okay.
Is that an answer?
Yeah. I got another question too.
Sure.
Speaking of the PKI, with the certificate, we can have two kinds of approaches. One is anchored trust model, and then the other one is unanchored trust model. Okay. With the unanchored trust model, you can just verify the signature. But with the anchored, and there will be pros and cons with both. So with the anchored, you can basically look for the certificate subject and certificate issuer. As long as those two match, you are good. So with this, you can renew the certificate every year. As long as keep the subject and the issuer consistent, you don't have any overhead for the app teams to repeatedly renew the certificate every year. So, but what are your thoughts between these two methods? Yeah.
So what you're calling your anchored method is sounding suspiciously close to what we normally call certificate pinning. And certificate pinning is considered to be a pretty bad idea. And what that is I'm going to take a system. So the whole point behind PKI is that there's something there that always works, and it's called the trusted root, right? There's a certificate authority, a CA. In the case of public certs, it's somebody like my company. In the case of private certs, you could be your own CA. You set it up in your own network, and you say, I am the arbiter for all certificates, and I'm going to declare which certificates are and which aren't. And the trust model that goes back to that CA, again, is mathematically unimpeachable, right? It's like laws of physics kind of unimpeachable, which means that you know that that root is really good. And then your CA, your certificate authority, your centralized certificate authority, knows what certificates are there, decides when to issue, decides when to revoke, decides when they should expire, decides what the other rules of governance are, and controls all of that. That is a very robust, sound system. Implemented correctly, it is very, very, very secure. Now you see people who want to put this extra layer, and all of a sudden they say, okay, well, I'm going to pin it. What does pin mean? It means that the certificate needs to say a certain thing. Certificate needs to have this value in this field, right? Or it needs to be from this, or it needs to have that. And the trouble with that is we see it over and over and over again. Here's what happens. Somebody writes an application. They put these requirements in. Everybody forgets about those requirements. They get on with their lives. They're doing things. One day, for some reason, they have to change their certs. Oh no, certificate expiration. Crisis, crisis, crisis. Get some certs. Here we go. Plug them in. And they don't freaking work. because 8 years ago, some guy who doesn't work here anymore pinned it to something that doesn't matter. So it sounds like a great idea. It often turns out to be a terrible idea, right? Every year we also see headlines, the following service is out. At the end of the day, it owes itself to something that's equivalent to certificate pinning, that making software that's requiring specific qualities of those certificates. That's not how the system is designed. That's what the trusted root and the CA are for. So I am going to, I won't say don't ever do it, because I guess I don't know all your circumstances, but that is fraught with peril. And I would suggest you think very carefully before you pursue that architecture. How's that for an answer?
Sounds good. Okay. I have another question, actually,
sure.
The last question.
Yeah.
I was just thinking this through when you're saying, so for the PIN, for the hybrid model, you said PIN plus PKI. For the hybrid model, PIN plus PKI. Any reason you think PIN is more secure? We can have a OTP or a long extended, like a secret.
Yeah.
Like a 40-character secret.
So OTP becomes its own conversation because OTP itself is a dozen different schemes, right? And then you got to look at every scheme, and some are better than others. So you say, okay, well, I'm going to do a phone call. Okay, well, that's fine. Now, is there a vulnerability? You bet. There's a SIM swapping vulnerability. So how does a SIM swapping vulnerability play in? Well, the script kiddie in Indonesia who's trying to steal my login for my bank account, never going to SIM swap me. Great solution to that problem. The APT in China who's trying to come steal my industrial secrets, absolutely can SIM swap me, doesn't solve that problem. So now what you do is you get one level deeper in terms of saying, what's the target, what's the payload, what's the potential attack, and is my MFA solving that attack? And under many circumstances, it is, but not universally under all circumstances. So again, with MFA, it's going to be kind of the same thing I said. You must tread there carefully, and you must know what you're doing and why, right? And there are lots of times when MFA is great. People make the mistake of thinking that MFA is universally perfect. And it never, yeah, I gotta go, I'm getting kicked off. Let's keep talking in the hall. And it never is universally perfect. It's always subject to some kind of attack. I've never seen an MFA that isn't subject to some kind of attack. All right, let's keep going in the hall, because I'm having fun.
Thank you.